pride and honor as we bring to you another gem in the league of immaculate scientists and artists gracing our stage this year. The man I am talking about is a man who needs no introduction. Coming from arguably the finest institution of research and innovation, light years ahead of any such institution in its league, I welcome this humble man from CERN, Dr. Marginesi. Dr. Nesi studied physics and mathematics at ETH Zurich. After the PhD and a short period as a postdoctorate at ETH on medium energy physics and accelerator-based mass spectrometry, he accepted a position at Rice University in Houston, USA, and changed to the field of experimental particle physics. Sir was the first spokesman of the RD34 project and later the project leader of the Atlas Hadron Tile Calorimeter that he conceived and led through construction. In 1996, he became a member of the CERN senior staff. In 1999, he was elected by the Atlas Scientific Collaboration overall technical coordinator. And since 2000, he is fulfilling that role at CERN with a mandate to lead the construction and to bring into operation this new gigantic detector, Atlas. He is also a member of the University of Geneva as titular professor in the physics department. And now, without further ado, I hand over the stage to Dr. Marginesi. It is a special announcement on Sir's request. If any of you has any query in between Sir's lecture, you can ask. You can ask any question. Sir. Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation. I am honored to be here. I have a secret agenda. I would like to try to convince you to all switch up to particle physics and become a member of CERN and of our activity. So what I am going to present you is this project at CERN, the LHC project. A project that our field has decided to carry. It's a very long project, 45 years long. We just are in the middle of the project. And what I will do at the beginning, try to give you the motivation why we are doing this. And then I will give you some insights on the project. And then I will tell you what we have discovered up to now, what we are trying to discover. I will go back very fast, very far, and I believe maybe I'll be superficial. If you have questions or you want to know more, you stop me, and if I'm able to answer, I will answer. So today, we know, looking at the sky, that there is something wrong in this picture. So we know, for example, if you look at galaxies, and we try to measure the velocity of rotation as a function of the radius of a star in that galaxy, we know that stars which are sitting on the external part of galaxies, somehow they are running too fast. And this, you would expect that the center of gravity of a galaxy is in the middle, and therefore the periphery will be seeing much less gravitational forces in order to rotate. Not the case. It looks like there is much more gravitational matter around each galaxy. So today it cannot explain that galaxy exists and how galaxy got formed. In 1998, some astrophysicists, which were studying
the speed of the of expansion of the universe, which started 13.7 billion years ago from a very tiny probably fluctuation, discovered that the universe for many years, for billions of years, is expanding in a linear way. But 4 billions of years ago, the universe started accelerating. So you tell me, if you accelerate, it means either inside you have something which pushes, or outside there is something which attracts. And we speak about that energy. So, altogether, after hundreds of years of knowledge, and being sure that we know a lot, we find out that what we know is our very knowledge of physics, all what exists in our books of physics, represent just less than 5% of all what we know in the universe. We speak about dark matter and dark energy. So this is a very strong point. So we were sure to know a lot, and in the last 10, 15 years, we discovered that we know very little. So, you can look at the big picture, but you can also look in the small world. You can go to very small distances and try to understand how the law figures of physics work. So, and even doing that, you will see we are in trouble, even in bigger trouble. So today, after almost 70 years of active research, we started in the 30s and even before this quantum mechanics, you were able to break down the atom in an electron, which is around a nucleus, and then in the last 30, 40 years, you were able to define that the nucleus is built up of protons and neutrons, and every time we were able to bring down the dimension of these objects until we arrive to define that all ordinary matter is made out of two types of quarks. We call the constituents of the proton-neutron quarks. And there are two types, up, we call it up, and the other we call it down. And we have and electrons, we build all the chemistry in this around. So with three particles, we are able to describe all what we know as material. This, besides the fact that the universe is 10 to 28 centimeters big in radius, such the components which build up the universe have show no dimension and show no internal structure. And this is a real problem. We went further, we tried in the lab to see if there are more of these constituents, and actually find out that there are, in the lab, we are able to produce three families of constituents. The one which we are used to live with, the electron and the up-down quark, but there are two other families, and which have the same properties, part the fact that second family, area, more mass than the first family, and the family number three has more mass. That if you scale, the top quark is as heavy as an atom of gold. So, and this family, they are not stable. Somehow they transmute, they decay in the stable particle. And this stable particle, find out they are really stable. We try to push them to see if they would decay. They are really stable. So all the quarks we are made of are there in the very beginning of the universe. So you are all 13.7 billion years old. First impressions, are quarks and electrons the fundamental entity of nature? Or there is another layer in this structure? Why are quarks and electrons sequentially repeat three times in three generations? So the third generation is useful because it made out all the what we know. But the other two somehow they appear there as completely superfluous in our world. And we know that nature of matter makes something which is superfluous. But there is one giant having three generations of quarks. And we don't know why all these quarks and electrons have different mass. What is the intrinsic mechanism which gives mass to particles? We went further. We understood, thanks to quantum mechanics, which was built at the beginning of the last century, we understand how all these particles of mass, or at least particles of matter, interact with each other, building up essentially all the dynamics that we know. We find out there are four fundamental forces in nature, and we are able to describe what a force is. And the force is nothing else as an exchange of information. And the messenger, this exchange of information, is nothing else as a particle again. So there are particles which are responsible for building the building blocks of nature, and there are particles which are responsible for the relation between these building blocks. So we went, we looked for all these messengers, and we know there are four forces, the strong force which is responsible for the nucleons staying together, there is the electromagnetic force which is responsible for the chemistry, for daily life, and there is the weak force which is responsible for the fact that some particles decay in each other, for example, the sun burns, responsibility of the weak interaction. So we found all the messengers, the blue one in one case, the photon in another case, and at CERN we discovered the W and Z boson, which is responsible for the weak interaction. There is another force, which is the gravitational force. We were never able to find out how this force fits in this picture. Up to now, we never found the messenger, we call it graviton. We look at stars, at supernovae explode to see the same a burst of such particles, and we are never able to. Somehow, gravity escapes us in the mathematical description of what we are doing with the other particles. So, we call all this the standard model with 12 basic particles of matter, 5 particle types which are mediating the forces. We asked for all of this a very fancy mathematical description, the field theory, based on the concept of Lagrange, based on some symmetry, some local transformation. And nothing we observe in nature violates this model. Nothing that we observe in nature, and we can look at what we know, violate this model. And the prediction that we can take out of the standard model has been fully confirmed in an astonishing way of precision. So we never, I think there is no other theory which has been measured so precisely as the standard model. Apart the fact that what we don't see is 95% does not fit in the standard model. Right. So we begin with serious doubts what we are doing. First of all, the standard model has at least 25 free parameters that we have to bring in order to make it work in some society. We have several hints of new physics. For example, we see that the neutrino oscillates between a status and another status in the three families on the way when they travel. The first result of this. We see that certain processes which involve some heavy quark framework, like G quark and C quark, have some violation of some fundamental symmetry. And again, this does not fit without this model. Furthermore, if we take this model and we push it at very high energy, at the very high energy which there at the beginning of the universe, the arc of ethics is diverges and becomes infinite. And this is again is not possible. So, further, there are questions that we would like to answer. And maybe we are not able to even to pose a question 20 years ago, but now we can ask a question. And we absolutely need to find an answer for it. So, like I was saying, we don't know what is the origin of mass. We speak about electroweak symmetry breaking because we don't know why the weak force and the electromagnetic force, which we have discovered as the same formulation, mathematical formulation, because at certain distances, photons and exchange at WMDR the same thing. So now the chosen 20 tetons have these two different masses. The photon has no mass and the W has mass. We don't know anymore what is space and what is time. Yet we begin to doubt that space is made out of three dimensions. There are theories which predict that space is made out of 11 dimensions. It's just that we don't see all of them. Gravity does not fit in this picture. And there are some basic questions. For example, we know that antimatter is a very common manifestation of matter, but somehow has disappeared from the picture. In the universe, there is very little antimatter. They are exactly, we never, they are really in high precision, everything looks to be really made out of the same thing. So, for sure, the standard model is not the end of the story. There must be an higher level of complexity, which are the guiding us. So we have a lot of theories. Our theoreticians are full of initiatives, and there are thousands of theories which explain what is the level of complexity which is around us. But we have to give the theoretician some insight of proof in which direction to go, but they cannot choose how to guide their thinking in the future. So here means doing an experimental proof becoming very important. And you will see all the particle physics have put together their resources and say, now is the time to do really the experiment, guide the theory towards the future. So, make it simpler. We have much more to understand with respect to what we thought we understood up to now. Even if 20 years ago, we are thinking we know everything. This might be another point of view. If you look at knowledge, kind of presented with this Jacob ladder, and you see the potential dimension, you see which knowledge you will approach. And you understand that in this level here, especially in microbiology and in life science, in atomic physics, everything sounds very complex. And this complexity probably has to do just with the fact that you have to see the picture from above. You have to go up in this step and try to take away this cloud. So the apparent chaos of the macroscopic world would be magically resolved as soon as an overview of what happens you see from above. So our goal in science today is to try to understand the macroscopic picture going to the very small dimension. We don't know how many steps we have here, maybe there are infinite steps, or maybe there are two or three steps to arrive there. So this was maybe pessimistic. On the optimistic side is we have a method to work with these questions. We have an experimental way to do in the lab, to learn, and to put all these questions on a test page. So what we have to do is make scattering or collisions of very energetic particles and produce very high density of energy in a very tiny space. And this will be kind of the new source of our microscope in order to find out what happens at very small distance. So, what we have to do is, we have to force same trans head-on collision of basic constituents at the highest energy we can afford. And today, technology allows us to go to energy which corresponds to 10 to the 12 electron volts. Remember, you are working in chemistry, people work in the desk. We create energy doing that, you know, because the two components that we collide are very tiny, and produce are 10 to minus 16 centimeters in the best case. We produce in a very small volume, very, very tiny, density of energy to which are very similar to the density of energy, which was just a fraction of seconds from the beginning of the Big Bang. A fraction of second is today, this technology can arrive to picoseconds of the Big Bang. So when the universe was as big as a golf ball. At the moment, when you do that, this very small space, this density, all nature, all the law of nature are present, because they were present at the beginning of the universe. And through the famous formula of Einstein, energy equals mass, you are able to transform energy in mass. So, can even produce masses or particles which are not the ones we are able to use. What we need is when these particles which are escaping us, which are not part of our current knowledge. So we'll make collisions, we'll make this identity of energy, produce new particles, and we isolate, and then we observe and we isolate dynamics that are not conform with the standard model. If you see something which escape our standard model, then fantastic, you can rewrite our proof of physics, because physics spans a new degree of freedom. So, just to give you a picture, the technology allows us to sit in this moment of the universe, the same density of energy, the same environment as it was in this electronic era, just after the inflation of this very microscopic body. So, for me, what I want to transmit to you is that we are facing in these years a fantastic cycle of knowledge. Essentially, I think, this is my personal belief, that we are in the same situation that we were at the beginning of the last century, where on one side, scientists like Kelvin and Michelson were very sure that it was the end of physics, that everything was known, that was no room for new discovery and a new enlargement of knowledge. But just after a few years, relativity and quantum mechanics arrived and changed, revolutionized our way to see science and visualize the way we even behave and how humanity can as a whole. But I think this year we are in a fantastic moment of science. So our playground for this is this large Hadron Collider that is CERN in Geneva, in Switzerland, but on the border in France. It's a 27-kilometer circumference machine. It's 100 meters underground, so it's a reference to see the airport of Geneva, and we are the mountains on the other side. No, so I will show you what happened. Sorry. Before I go, I'll show you what happened inside the accelerator. So we are sitting, the host laboratory, CERN was built in 1954 by 12 nations built together and wanted to keep their scientists working together without special European scientists to protect their knowledge and not let the scientists go across the world. And today, the founders of the become from 12 20 member states, plus another set of observers and states which are trying to get in, and at a certain point will be part, full part of CERN. Today CERN is an environment of about 10,000 people which are working together, 2,000 staff maintain the infrastructure, and about 1,000 users, which are physicists, students like you, which come to CERN to participate in these experiments and make use of this infrastructure. For CERN, as today, as all these nations, which one way or the other participate, and also financially participate, and essentially all the planets where there is a faculty of energy physics or nuclear physics, as somebody is participating in this experiment. And sometimes you get very important visits that you appreciate. So what happens at this collider? You turn over 27 kilometers to make protons running in one direction and protons running in another direction in two separate pipes. You accelerate them to go almost at speed of light, or as much you can, energy and that you can afford to keep them on a circle. So this direction, to put trains of protons, their distance about 7.5 meters, which is 25 nanoseconds, and you see them staggering these trains of protons circulate that way and that way. And in two places, let the two beams intercept and collide so that this bunch of protons collide with this bunch of protons, and with a small probability, one proton, here there are something like 10 to the 11 protons, one proton here interact with one proton here to a central collision and give this huge energy base. So, to measure the rate of what you are doing, we speak about luminosity, which luminosity is proportional to the number of particles on one beam, the number of particles on the other beam, divided by the cross-section of the beam. So smaller the beam is, higher is the probability to make a collision. And you multiply this number with the physical cross-section to make a process, you get the rate of the process you are going to look at. Give you an idea, the beam, when it collides, that the size of an air is something like 20 microns in diameter. So you have 20 microns to circulate 27 kilometers, and 20 microns to circulate 27 kilometers, and they collide head on. And particles do 11,000 times per second the turn of this ring, so they go at speed of light. Today we are operating this machine at about half of the energy and about half of the luminosity that we were designing. And we are going to go up slowly because we are trying to understand how this machine works. So, in this tunnel, in fact, a lot of technology. So, essentially what you need is magnets, which give the particle circulating, and then you need a vacuum chamber, that the vacuum, which is very, very few molecules inside, the vacuum that you find especially in the intergalactic phase. So the most challenging component of this accelerator are these 1,232 magnets, which are providing a magnetic field vector of 8 Tesla, which is a lot of fields. And this is provided by having this magnet running at very low temperature, these coils which are made out of superconducting wire, they're something like 7.6 thousand kilometers of neodymium titanium, which is a superconducting wire, in a vase of superfluid helium at 1.9 Kelvin. 1.9 Kelvin, this material becomes superconducting, and this element can produce very high magnetic. So the entire 27 kilometers sit at less than 2 Kelvin, which is colder than the outer space, because you know that the outer space has a temperature of 3 Kelvin given from the background radiation of the Big Bang. So how does an accelerator work? Essentially what you have to do, you have to keep the particle running in circle, and you do this bending magnets, which are field, B field, perpendicular to the ring, so that you have a centripetal force from the electromagnetic, from the magnet, keep that running in the ring. You have to accelerate through cavities, superconducting cavities, which are bending waves, electromagnetic waves. You have to accelerate, you have to give a kick every time the particle goes through for about half an hour, or to reach the maximal energy. And then you have to focalize this beam because protons are heavy. Don't do anything after microsecond, a proton is pulled down about 1 meter to the gas. We have to focalize the focalizing elements. So you have something like 10,000 magnets that we have to keep, which are very precise, and we have to check which tip is object line. In practice, what you do, you start from a bottle of gas, and you accelerate slowly, you take away the electron, you accelerate in an electric field, linear magnetic field, until you arrive to the energy you can be good injected in this flickering electron. Essentially, what we are doing, since 55 years, we are constructing accelerators. We kept all running, and slowly we managed to get all this complex to serve the final complex. And all this runs in the surface, and more you go down, to the 1 meter underground, you find the newest machine. So we are able to keep machine running for 56 years. We tell you that we need a high level of technology to do that. So essentially a machine corresponds, is built up in 8 seconds. You have to make sure the trajectory from one ring and the other ring as the millimeter are the same. So you have to make it interpret sometimes it goes in, sometimes it goes out, and you have to repeat the element cells which have this dipole magnet, correction magnet, and then they are focalizing again. These are cells of about 400 meters, 3 or the entire cell. So it's really technologically a big complex. Just to give you an idea, such a complex is so big that it deforms under the moon influence, and you have to correct in order to make sure that this path is kept perfectly under control. So from picture you see the tunnel view that is about 4 meters in diameter that I told you for cryogenic. Cryogenic is a science we are just learning, the science of the future, and there are a lot of things in order to make this operational and effectively run for the future. The main components are these magnets, superconducting magnets, which is at 1.9 Kelvin. And which you insert something like 12,000 amperes to produce this high field. And this is about an object of the. So what is different from what we were doing before? They've increased by a factor of 2 the magnetic field, they've increased by a factor of 7 the beam energy, and we have put much more energy inside the system, stored energy. Today we are running about 11 gigajoules, is more or less the energy which such a ship carries when it runs at that speed. But essentially, you have ships like that inside these tunnels, which you have to keep under control if you want to run effectively. So, now comes the interesting thing. So, you use this beam and you make collisions. I told you, very tiny, in very tiny space. In this tiny space, where then you retransform energy in mass, you have very high density, which are similar to the original universe. If you would put a thermometer there and measure the temperature, you would find out that the temperature there in this very tiny space is about 1,000 million times more than the temperature inside our sun. So it's really, you are speaking about many orders of magnitude from what we are using. What you want to do is around this place, put a fancy microscope and take a picture of what happened there during the collision. So, our accelerator is 7 kilometers, placed underground, and in 4 places we have put very large detectors, particle detectors. 2 of them, Atlas, the biggest part, and then there is CMS, the sister, Atlas. And there, these two detectors are there to make really big discoveries. They are like the Christopher Columbus going around the globe to try to find something. So these are ready for any discovery. And then we put there 2 smaller experiments, something like a factor of 10 less complex, which are just there to look at some specific things that we want to understand. So the beams near to these collision points, they get together. In one direction, they run practically on the same plane. in order to make this head-on collision. And in the other direction, they come with an angle because if they run too close, there is so much particle and electromagnetic force here that the two beams will just disturb the order. And this just in the last 2-300 meters near to the collision point. So typically, we feel the acceleration. It takes about 2 hours to ramp it down, to go to zero field, to inject new particles from the previous accelerator. It takes half an hour to energize and bring the particle to the speed of light, then focalize in order to make collisions, and then to go to physics, and you are doing physics for 10-20 hours. After 10-20 hours, the residual gas in the vacuum disturbs the beam, and the beam became not focalizable anymore, so we throw it away and do this type of test. Essentially, for about 8 months, 9 months per year, as far as we can pay the electricity, because we consume as much electricity in this game as the entire city of Geneva. We run day and night, and then in winter, like in December, January, we go to shut down and we make maintenance of the system. So, in 2008, we had the first start. We start circulating beam in one direction, and this was for us a major event. And here, the beam builds up. And we set the magnet according to our knowledge and our simulation. So the engineers have done a great job of simulating all what can happen and what are the best trajectories. And they were able in the first shot to go around the ring. And we were all very happy, so it was a startup. But after 3 days, tiny error in one of the superconducting supplies, so in my 10,000 supplies, in the network of superconductivity, had a failure, probably not done, was not correctly measured, and was a shortcut inside, and yet we had to take 3-4 months to warm up everything, make some repair, and then 3-4 months. Close down and go down to Kelvin, because if you go too fast, you ruin the material. You go very quickly, very slowly, to very low temperature. So in 2010, Master and Ted, here we start colliding this time at half of the energy, because we don't want to take too many risks anymore. And from then, here, we went up, up, and up in intensity. And last year, in 2011, we were able to deliver enough statistics to the experiment such that somehow we rediscover all the standard model and we make again a lot of measurements and precise precision of what was known. And we began with enough statistics to enter in the regime where you would find unknown effects, unknown things, and I will tell you in a moment what you are finding. So somehow we move to a path where every 3 years we take data for 3 years, then we stop for 1 year, 3 years of data taking, then we stop. And every time we stop, we make sure the machine and the detectors are going to be upgraded so that we can face the new challenge and all the technology is keeping up to date. And we are going to run probably until 2035. So we have all the time to join and be part of this. So this is already started in 89, 90, and we are going to run into 2035, so 45-year project. But let me go down again to this picture. So we want to put around this top, this center, we want to put a microscope. Now, this microscope, in this case, no matter the other detector, is the one I know best, because I'm running it, is an object of 7,000 tons, 90 million sensors. So it's about 55 meters long and about 30 meters high, like a building of 10, 11 floors. It's really built up of an incredible amount of technology. I think if you do a picture of that, to get the impression on the where technology sits at the beginning of this millennium. So essentially what you do, all the particles that are produced in the center travel to this detector, and as function of their property, they get measured and they identify the energy of each particle and the type of particle you are dealing with. This reaction here happens very fast, 10 to the minus 24 seconds, but the propagation through the matter of the particles which have survived and which have become stable is at the level of nanoseconds. So, I give you some pictures that you see the complexity from the fuse engineering. Many of you are engineers, so you see, will appreciate the complexity, the engineering complexity of the object. Here is seen these two rings here. Okay? Here is seen when you take away this leaf and you look from inside, you see an incredible amount of cable, of pipes, cooling, in the detectors, a lot of cryogenic liquids, magnets, and so on. And here is a very center of the detector of 3 meters from here inside with the collisions, and the most dense detector is the one which sees the collision, maybe 2 centimeters from the reaction. This if you are a scale, these are components. We started with building up a big cavern, 100 meters underground, and filling slowly this very big element. So you can idea this is a 400-ton element go down in the cavern at once. So these are, let's say, we give you the scale of the project, like if we have constructed something like 25, 30 large satellites that if we could bring it to the sky, we go down to the ground, and each satellite has its own technology, on construction methods, testing methods, and so on. So, very important to maximize the probability to make a collision. We have 40 million collisions per second, every 25 nanoseconds. So we have to, this machine takes 40 million of pictures per second. And it produces something like 1 petabyte of data every second. You cannot store 1 petabyte. There is no technology to store 1 petabyte. We have to become very smart, and the machine itself has to decide what to keep and what to throw away. At the end, what they keep is the equivalent of 2 CD per second, and even that is enormous because running 1 year for that, we produce 10 petabytes of data to analyze. So this machine is not just big and fancy, but it's also incredibly smart in order to find which physics to keep and which physics to describe. So this is typical events. This is a very fancy event where we produce 2 energetic W and Z vector bosons, which are responsible for the leak interaction, which are very rare, never saw before events like that. And we are able to study them in great detail and understand their characteristics. So if you are scale, if you go down here to the big pipe, you find one picture, every 25 nanoseconds, you see a picture like that, where you see all this mess of particles coming out, and then you can distinguish which one are the direct. For example, this is a Z decay in 2 muons, which come out. But there's a lot, hundreds and hundreds of other particles that are just escaped, which makes the analysis here very complex. So we started in 1989, this project. In 1992, we have presented to the community a letter of intent what we want to do. We've done a lot of R&D. Essentially, 20 years ago, we knew which technology we wanted, and we were able to find out how to continue, and we are able to nail down the technology we wanted. So you are very young, but some of your teachers probably remember how was the technology in 89, how was the telephone and the fax machine were in 89. And at that moment, we were already there in the technology with the leading edge today. So we are a community which just not just produce science, but also produce technology in a proactive way. And we go in partnership with the industry, and we propose and we teach them how to go to work in technology. In 1994, we signed a contract between ourselves to see what we want to do, and we started writing the blueprint that we wanted to construct. And starting there, we started constructing for about 12 years, and in 2008, we were ready to start the exploitation of this machine. So 500 years ago, science was a matter of one single individual, Leonardo in this case. Today, such kind of activity are done through an incredible network. We have to do this experiment, we have 3,000, more than 3,000 scientists working together across the planet. India is not in this picture because India is in on the CMS detector, not in ATLAS, this is the ATLAS collaboration. Very important is this type of science is driven by students. So the real brains behind all this are students. We have in ATLAS about 1,000 PhD students, and every year we produce 300 PhD theses. And these people are spread in the 175 universities which participate in this activity and in 38 countries. So who are we really? We are a strange community, maybe unique if you want, because we are the supplier and the customer ourselves. We are able to propose experiments, propose technology, design it, construct it, to become the customer ourselves. We are able to exploit what we want to do, and we are the guys going around looking for the money, not for this. So, not a matter of individuals, not a matter of having genius in the place, it's a matter of having an incredible network of knowledge work together, and this is probably the, one of the newest things in science is the fact that people work to network and they are able to collaborate together in an effective way in this mega project. So I would say the best way to define who we are is like ants, and every ant has his role, has his knowledge, and contributes to the success of the story. Why these projects are difficult? Because they are very long-lasting, 20 years construct them, 35 years of exploitation, including upgrading the new technology. It's a very complex technology in the sense that you yourself are a factor of 10 in complexity to what we are able to do before. Although for us, professional of this is difficult. It's a very large international community which has to be organized and here and get together for 45 years. The resources, even if there are billions dollars for this kind involved, even the size of the technology and you know how technology is expensive, are still modest, and you need an high level of communication and recommendation in order to arrive to a concrete product. And like I say, we are producing an incredible amount of data. We produce something like 10 petabytes per year, which are something like 10 million of gigabytes. You know what the size of your computer is, 100,000 of your PCBs per year to analyze. And we are not, we cannot make errors because we got the money once, and if we fail, we will not be given the money twice. So this is really collaborative effort across the planet, a global project, probably the biggest one I've never attempted. Science, putting too many people and too many resources all together. Just to give you on the way we operate, to keep 3,000 or more people together, just to allow a level of democracy is already at the limit. You don't have to have a big, big prima donna, you have to have people which are all running in the same way, be more very democratic. And this is an example. When we publish a paper, the paper normally consists of 7-8 pages of scientific content, but it consists of 13 pages of names of the 3,000 authors. and treat the alphabetical, and the institution treat the alphabetical, but nobody goes up in front of anybody else. And this is a fundamental way to not break out the competition inside the people, and people just will break down and everybody will go home and go to the one. People, so many people for so many years around the face, an incredible democracy there. So today we have changing the data we speak in 2011. We have produced 120 physics papers on major learners, I think in the review and so on. So essentially we produce one scientific paper every 3 days. That is difficult up here. Let's wait. There we go. So, just putting together all this information, sharing information to journals, is a major enterprise. So you know that you also write paper, so you know how much it takes to write a good, high standard paper. You produce one per every 3 days, and you produce practically every day a scientific note for a conference. Okay, let's go now to the physics, and then we come back to that matter. What did he discover up to now, running in especially 2 years? So first of all, this machine is a fantastic factory of standard model particles. We produce something like 10 hertz of top quarks, so we have millions of top quarks produced as in by the detector. We produce every flavor. You look at 1 million of pairs of P quarks and C quarks. We produce even W's at the level of 100 pairs, and jets quarks, which go very near one to the other, a very small distance, produce an enormous amount. So this is already a factory for us, for a particle physics, which are supersede any machine that exists on the planet. So everybody is putting down the machine and simply going there to continue the experimentation. So I will give you 4 examples of the physics we are doing right now, which is, you know, it's just a small section because we are doing much more. So standard model, quark-gluon plasma, Higgs boson, and supersymmetry. So here is an example of the most common cross-section. Highest cross-section here in physics is to get the production of 2 quarks or 2 gluons, which come out back to back. This is the most common mechanism when you transform energy into matter. And the function of the transverse momentum, you go that the 2 protons were as near as possible, and the density of energy was as high as possible. Going in this direction, you go towards the oldest universe. Here you see how today's standard model on the calculation corresponds to what we measure. So we measure over 14 order of magnitude with high precision what we can predict this theory. That means we have a knowledge of our theory, which is really very, very pushy. So I think it's rare in science to find a theory so fundamental and yet so well tested experimentally. So, first of all, standard model is very well measured, a very small distance. Second, every year for 1 month, instead of putting protons in the beam, we put lead. Lead has more than 200 nuclei. So more than 600 quarks, which means another 600 quarks and a lot of gluons. So it's a mess when the 2 high energy collide together. So we think that we are hoping to find a new phase of matter which corresponds to a quark gluon plasma, which is essentially the soup which was there 1 microsecond after the Big Bang, and which was the basis to form galaxies and stars. So what we have seen, I will show you, we have seen this quark-gluon plasma, and we are starting now measuring the property of this new material. So what happens if two quarks collide and they do the standard thing, they produce two neutrino quarks, because the quarks cannot live alone, but they materialize, transforming their energy in particles, you get a stream of particles coming out in one direction, a stream of particles coming out in another for jets. Now, if the jets produce at the periphery, one jet gets out in this third, and the other jet gets absorbed by the quark-gluon plasma, because it's like a medium in which you travel. And indeed, we saw that when the jets are produced at the periphery, you get two jets in the mouth. If the jet is produced in the center of the quark-gluon plasma, there is one jet which comes out, and the other jet gets destroyed and gets spread in space. And what we are doing now, we are measuring the property of that new matter. And this is very interesting for us, astrophysics. The other thing is the famous Higgs boson. Why nature has decided to manifest itself as mass and not as energy? Why we are not just energy and we are every star? So, we think that this is a property of space. So essentially, Mr. Higgs and other colleagues in the 60s came out with the idea that if you empty space from everything you know, take out everything, the most stable condition is not a space which is empty, but it's a space which is full of a radiation, which we call X radiation or X field. Particles move with our quarks and gluons, which interact, move in the space, interact with this field, and through this interaction, they get slowed down. And that if you walk in the mud, and you have difficulties to move, if you interact with the mud. And doing that, you become heavy, and you get away. This is a deep understanding of the X mechanism. So space, the nothing does not exist, not stable. You will not never find nothing, you will always find a space, something is like a field. If you give a little bit of activation to the X field, some of these particles aggregate and form what they call an X boson, which can appear in our world. And we are looking for this boson. So the theory tells us how to produce, how this is the probability to produce an X boson, and how this X boson decays, but doesn't tell us where this boson is in mass, where we have to find it. So, depending on the mass, it can decay, it can behave in a different way. So we started looking for all these masses, and to get very heavy mass, we need a lot of energy in heavy object. And recently, and I tell you this is not conclusive, we find two channels. We found little bumps like this, like an X decaying in two photons, or an X decaying in two Zs, two vector boson, and two vector boson then decaying in two leptons, two muons, or two electrons. And we find an excess above what standard model tells us of two particles. So is this just an indication, not conversion, because we need most of it. So we see events like this, where four leptons coming out, and we calculate the mass of what has generated this around 125. And we see it in two different channels. And the two experiments, the same thing. And we went back to the Americans, a machine which is lower energy, but we begin to see in the same region something which does not fit with an excess of something. So there is a good chance that the X is there. Statistically, we are not enough, but we have scientific methods that you have to be sure, at least best, less than one per bill, that this is not an effect of the ground, of random building up of the rates. And today, we are still compatible with the ground, it's a level of 1.4%. So we take the entire 2012 to at least until summer to double the statistic or even more, to see if this is true or is just a fluctuation, a random fluctuation of the background. This is true. This is really exciting period because we opened a window on new physics, because with an instant at that mass, there must be other factors that give the mass to the X and constrain the mass to the X at this level. So this is a really exciting moment. So 2012, please watch the news. If we manage to confirm that, it's really a revolutionary for physics. So we have just sent out recently the first physics letter which summarized for this, just marking the territory in this one. Now, this is right. The next thing to look at is there is an higher level of complexity in the universe. And one of the most prominent theories is supersymmetry. So remember the particle of matter and the particle of force. So the particle of matter is characterized by one quantity, which is the spin. And the spin is always a fraction, one half, three half, something like that. And having the spin one half, according to the Pauli principle, it allows you to build atoms and to build the biology and to build all what we know. And it's important for us that the interaction forces bosons in 0 or 1 in order to build what we know today. Now, why not nature at the highest level work in a symmetric way? That there exists a world where the particle of matter has spin 0 or 1 and the particle of force has spin 1 and a half or 3 and a half and so on. Because of the Pauli principle, this cannot be an atom. You can just stay segregated in the universe. And this, if you remember the story of the gravitation around the star, this could be a very good candidate for the dark matter. Because this part of this, there are like clouds which have been released of the Big Bang, which are sitting everywhere in the universe, and they are sensible to gravitational force, and so they need interaction. On top of that, if they exist, they will solve one of the biggest problems in the standard model, is to find a description for all the forces which is unique. We found a description for two of the forces, the electromagnetic and the weak force, but we didn't find a common description for the strong force. If we introduce this particle in a magic way, all the forces at very small distances will become one single description, one single formula, mathematical formula. This is very, very elegant. And this is a big trick. Problem is that we don't know how this particle, supersymmetric particle, decays. It might decay in many ways. So we have many theories, hundreds of theories, on the way they are decaying. Right now we are looking at the most simple theory. And the most simple theory is that at the end of the decay, the lightest stable particle, we call a neutralino, is a particle that can remain in the universe and build up the entire universe. Neutral, it's light, it's neutral, and just interact with gravitational and the much interaction, but it's probably very heavy. So in this process, we know the process of the calculation. So in this process, we build this. And this supersymmetric particle will decay in this neutralino and the particle we know. So if you are looking at an event, you are looking for particles that we know a lot, and particles which carry a lot of energy that we don't know, which is stable at the level. So we see an imbalance in the energy conservation of the event we are looking at. We have looked for a moment with all the mean we have, and we have found that if it exists, this particle is heavier than 1 keV. We need more energy, so in 2 years we have double the energy and we will see how far it will go. And at the same time, we begin to look for other theories, how this might decay. And they say that more complex theory, and they are following what this has been. In the next 2 to 3 years, we can find an end for this supersymmetric part. Is that come alive? It's really very elegant, and it will open a new set of physics. A lot of books. So in summary, LHC is really now in a reality, it's running, and it's starting answering very fundamental questions on the frontier of knowledge. It will be operational for the next 20 years, and it will change the way you understand physics. Already it has changed now the way you understand physics. It's an incredibly complex project, both from the Toronto point of view and from the physics point of view. It's a global project in science, a very important source of training and education for the new generation of scientists, and new generation of scientists, people like you. So you are all invited to join in this effort. So I might finish with a sentence that I like a lot. This one of Stephen Hawking, a famous astrophysicist in England, says, "We are just an advanced breed of monkeys on a minor planet, a very other star, but we can understand the universe." That made us something very special.
I would request anyone who is any questions?
On the shy. Yes, please.
Research, you found neutrinos which are constantly traveling the speed greater than a velocity.
Yes. So about 6 months ago, one experiment, Opera, speaking not of CERN, but speaking in Italy, but get a beam of neutrino coming from CERN. Was measured from this strength. Now, like I told you, now if you want to be a strict scientific person, you have to do the experiment with high precision, you have to know all what you have done. So some reason, somebody let out this information without much check, and he went in all the journals because it's very, very appealing to find out that Einstein was wrong. Unfortunately, Einstein still right. So we went, we did a major effort to check, cross-check everything. We did a second experiment nearby to see if there is something which is escaping, and was found what the reason of this. So there is no neutrino will go faster than light. Light is the maximum of speed that today we know. And this very high precision, this precision of centimeters. Yes, so one of the other experiments that measured some neutrinos which are coming from somewhere else, and we found was compatible with zero. And then we found the reason was a technical reason in the electronic was some signal took some time to go up, and this introduced a delay in the entire chain. But the best proof that neutrino and light was the same speed is in 87 was supernova exploding, and two detectors on the planet measured at the same time a burst of neutrino and burst of photons, then the photon arriving on the planet. And they will be very synchronized. And this process traveled millions of years to arrive to us. So if there was a tiny difference in the speed of light, we would have seen the two events be not correlated. So what's important is the message that we want to carry is science has some rules. You have to be very strict in the way you apply scientific method. You have to check everything. You have to go to this 5 sigma deviation in order to confirm the statistics. And like in any society, there's always somebody who is not there to enough. It was the best spot for us.
So, one obvious problem
is
that by the time
Opera
announced results of this kind
of
people said that, you know,
the
Fermi lab,
and I think
Michigan
was going to compare to Polaro. Yeah, it was another experiment which has seen it. Similar results,
yeah.
But with a very big error. And this is always, when you go on a measurement, the error dominates the truth. The error means something. So you can be on this side, on the other side. But now the measurement is very, we have sent particles every nanosecond. So we have learned how to start the clock and stop the clock. And we make very precise measurements. Exactly the same. So, the end of the story. unfortunately, because it would have been fantastic for science to find something like that, but it was not.
No.
You remember, you were in the middle of the Cold War. And if you, these many nations which are fighting, and somehow people, and these are their princes, have thought the best place to be is a very stable political place, where everything is calm, nobody fights. And Switzerland was a neutral country, was chosen for for this thing. And it's also, another reason is also in the center of Europe, so it's easy for everybody to understand. So it was a pure political and managerial decision. Petabyte of data means we'll put it in a CD, we'll have 20 or 25 kilometers of CDs, and on top of the other, analyze. So you need an enormous amount of CPU to analyze that. Because what you want is to reconstruct each picture, find all of it, and try to find the only like 100 fellowships per year for people to come to serve. And if you want really to apply for a job, to apply to a usual mechanism like you when you apply to a university as a faculty or a postdoc and so on. But this, the amount of people paid by CERN is really limited. We are something like 200 physicists. And most of the people are engineers and high-level technicians, because it's CERN has to maintain the infrastructure. So really the knowledge and the brain of CERN is distributed in all the universities around the planet, which use CERN as an infrastructure. If you want to join as a student, just go to one of your local universities which is working with CERN, and you will be part of this.
Now we, in this...
For everybody who wants to ask questions, I stay here, you can come and I ask prior to the question. All the time.
Yes, thank you, sir. Not only is it a great honor to stand here in his company, but to share your experiences with the once in a lifetime opportunity. A very big honor. Also, I thank all the professors and all the students who joined us in this afternoon. And now I request Professor R.R. Mishra, senior member of the physics department, to kindly give sir the memento as a token of appreciation from us. Sir, please.